much for the kind invitation. It's a great pleasure to participate in this conference. So the official name of my university is Philips. The official name of my university is Philips University, and at the bottom here you can see Philip the magnanimous, who founded the university in 1527, so he was not related to the electric company. Okay, so, pardon me? No, neither light bulbs or anything. Well, anyway, this ought to be a talk on Higgs bundles, and I can say that everything will go through for Higgs bundles. We have the methods, but this is not quite the focus of what I would like to talk about. And so let me begin with some motivation and remind you of the situation of the classical moduli space of compact Riemann surfaces. So there is the linear manifold compact multiplication denoted by MP bar. And so we have a divisor at infinity, or say the compactifying divisor rather. And Manifold's bundle carries a Hermitian matrix, they call it HQ, it ought to be a capital Q, whose curvature form is actually the Weil-Petersson form, which was constructed in a totally different way. And so the reason why we want to look at this kind of approach is it allows us to use the methods of Kaehler geometry. Now, the metric on Manifold's bundle extends to the compactification, to the linear Manifold compactification, as a singular Hermitian metric on a certain line bundle where we have to subtract certain components of the compactifying divisor. And while the metric is not that singular, actually it is continuous at the boundary, and minus logarithm of the metric is strictly plurisubharmonic. So that is the best one can have, and so it would also mean that this bundle is a positive bundle in the usual sense. Then, of course, the curvature form of HQ then by definition is a positive current. We would say that positivity for currents means semi-positivity for matter of definition. And this is the situation. And what we have in mind when moving to holomorphic vector bundles. Now, conversely, we can say, rather make a rough statement, that the extension of a curvature form as a positive current implies an extension of the corresponding holomorphic line bundle. And some notation for holomorphic vector bundles. Since we are interested in Kaehler geometry, we need to look at holomorphic families. So a holomorphic family of holomorphic vector bundles parameterized by some parameter space S, by definition, is given by a holomorphic vector bundle on the total space, whose restrictions to fibers X times S a bar are just the given elements, the given members of our family. So that theoretically, the moduli space consists of isomorphism classes of, say, stable holomorphic vector bundles. And then, of course, for given any such family, we can assign to a point in the base the corresponding isomorphism class of the vector bundle. And so that is a set theoretic map, and the most we can get out of it is a quotient topology. Now, if we take the analytic standpoints for constructing moduli spaces, then there are various issues. One is the Hausdorff property of the quotient topology, and one can see that it is very closely related to the existence of a complex structure on the base, and or on the moduli space. And the answer in our situation would be the existence of unique Hermite-Einstein connections. And so then we know if we have, say, something like a family of bundles and the connections are only defined off some singular set or off some except off some certain subset, then we know that Hermite-Einstein connections would connect, converge to Hermite-Einstein connections. From there, one can get the Hausdorff property. And then there is, of course, the issue of an algebraic structure, which I'm not going to talk about. And our main point is a differential geometric structure on the moduli space. So as we already mentioned, the holomorphic structure is closely related to the variation of Hermite-Einstein connections. And from there, one could say, well, let's take the infinitesimal variation of a Hermite-Einstein connection and integrate against the Kaehler form and the Hermitian metric, then we get L2 metric on the base, or say generalized by Weil-Petersson metric, and which is a Kaehler. And what I'm going to talk about is the extension theorem for such for the corresponding Kaehler form. Then, as an application, one would get from a positive line bundle on M, or a certain positive line bundle on M, one can get from there to a line bundle on a certain compactification. So here we cannot specify the compactification, which is one issue here. Okay, so this line bundle would be some analog of Manifold's bundle lambda, and it would be a determinant line bundle, and we will come to that, how to introduce such a thing. In the end, we will have, on one hand, the Weil-Petersson current, and on the other hand, the Chern form of the this object, the determinant line bundle, equipped with a certain metric, which is HQ, and Q stands for Quillen. Okay. So we want to talk today about orbifold structures, and let me fix the notation. We will use orbifold charts. So there is an open subset of a complex number space. Then there is a discrete group, so such that the quotient W mod gamma is given, and this is a model for the space. So these orbifold charts defined on a, say, on a topological space with certain conditions would fit together. And the definition of an orbifold atlas only requires the definition of, or the notion of, an embedding. And this is what we have here. So it means that there is a holomorphic open embedding of the open subsets Wi into Wj of a complex number space. And everything has to be compatible with the group action. And the compatibility condition is this year the one we expect. All right. Now, the notion of an orbifold vector bundle is exactly what we expect. On all of these spaces, Wi sitting in Cn, we have holomorphic vector bundles. with a gamma I equivariant actions, and those fit together in the expected way. So this is the setup. And so given a complex orbifold or the manifold, the underlying normal complex space is then denoted by X. And then we are looking at, well, vector bundles, so the tangent and cotangent vector bundles certainly are orbifold vector bundles, and then one can look at sheaves of equivariant holomorphic orbifold forms or functions. Well, these amount to coherent sheaves on X with some extra condition. And if we apply this to an orbifold line bundle, what we get at the bottom is a coherent sheaf, no more than that. But after taking a certain power, then it will be will descend to X as a holomorphic line bundle. The power K kills the characters from the definition. So there is this situation. So then we copy the definitions of the Godefroy and Deram complexes to orbifold forms. And so then we have all resolutions of a certain kind. So all computations take place upstairs. And everywhere we say invariant, gamma I invariant. The only thing is we can say is constant holomorphic orbifold sheaves descend as constant sheaves on at the bottom. So here, finally, this is the resolution of the sheaves of locally constant functions on the base. Okay. Yeah. So there is one point to keep in mind. We have seen before that that an orbifold differential form, be it of class C infinity, will only descend to bottom as a form with a continuous coefficients. Fine. So then we have the notion of orbifold Hermitian vector bundles. And so these give us the notion of orbifold curvature forms and so on. So we don't expect anything particular. So a Kaehler orbifold form is of the same kind. It descends to the base space with the continuous coefficients. And here we have the notion of a positive Hermitian orbifold line bundle. All right. So in this case, we say that the orbifold is of Hodge type. And the classical theorem of Bailey says that invariant sections of such a line bundle give, or powers of that give rise to a embedding into a projective space. So the underlying space is in that case a projective normal space. Okay. Now, once we are that far, we can write down the degree of holomorphic vector bundle. This is exactly what we expect, and we have the notion of stability. And then we look at the Uhlenbeck-Jau theorem, and we can copy every line and just adding the line gamma I invariant to each step of the proof, because all of the all of the estimates take place on the orbifold charts, namely on the spaces W sitting as open subspaces of CF. And so then there exists the moduli space of stable orbifold bundles, and also it exists from the point of view of complex analysis. And so we are in a position to study this moduli space or these moduli spaces. The extra assumption will be that the determinant of the all of these vector bundles is supposed to be fixed. And this assumption will be used at various places. On the other hand, this is nothing unexpected from the viewpoint of holomorphic, from the viewpoint of moduli spaces of stable vector bundles. All right, so here is now the moduli space. And yeah, well, now we come to a Kaehler structure. So if we want to understand or introduce a Kaehler structure on a moduli space, we need to describe the tangent spaces in an intrinsic way. And of course, this is done in terms of the Kodaira-Spencer mapping. So we assume that we are given a holomorphic orbifold vector bundle on X times S, which defines a family of stable holomorphic vector bundles with fixed determinant bundle. Then we look at the Kodaira-Spencer map. And in order to put a natural L2 product on the tangent space so that we have a Hermitian structure on the moduli space. Now, we need some notation, which is what we want. We will have to pull back the Kaehler form to the total space. The parameter directions will usually considered as flat directions. Okay, and to make life easier, we have this thing, which makes all binomial coefficients equal to one. And then the usually the easiest thing is to use check cohomology to compute the first cohomology with values in the endomorphism bundle of a holomorphic vector bundle. In this case, we want to use Dolbeau cohomology in order to make use of Hermitian metric and Kaehler metrics and so far. So we use the Atiyah sequence, which is an extension of the tension bundle by the endomorphism bundle and given by the curvature of the curvature, by the cohomology class of the curvature of E, for instance. And then we can see that any connection on the total space gives rise to a intrinsic description of the Kodaira-Spencer map. We write down the cohomology sequence, and the edge homomorphism is then given by a connection. And then, of course, we take the connection of the Hermite-Einstein structure. All right, so the edge homomorphism takes care of this. So this is some abstract description of a very simple effect, namely, well, here is one notation. So we need coordinates on the base space and coordinates on the holomorphic orbifold. And everything goes through for singular base spaces, but that is not really the problem here. So we take, well, maybe S is minimally embedded in a complex number space, then this makes sense, or we just assume that S is smooth. That is not the problem here. And as I said, we have a very a simple description of the Kodaira-Spencer map. So what we do is we take the Hermite-Einstein connections on the fibers and take a horizontal derivative. That is all what we want. And here in that case, it's a 0, 1, so we could also take then the conjugate. And anyway, so this thing is known if we know the Hermite-Einstein connections on the fibers and we take the derivatives in the flat S direction. Then we get on all of these fibers, we come up with a 0, 1 form with values in the endomorphism bundle. And it turns out that this thing represents the Kodaira-Spencer class, but it is even harmonic. And the harmonicity is a very simple thing. We write down what d bar star is, so we need the Kaehler form to contract this. Then we use one of these identities for curvature forms like this. And then we have capital lambda times identity, which is constant for all the same lambda for all fibers. And then we take the derivatives with respect to the parameters, and of course we get zero. So that is the harmonicity of these representatives. And now we are in a position that we have natural representatives of the Kodaira-Spencer classes, and the construction is functorial, where functorial just means compatible with base change, and in particular, no matter which kind of families we start from, everything will descend to the moduli space. So we have some intrinsic definition, and here is the inner product, trace of fi beta bar, f alpha j bar, and then contract to the Kaehler form and take then the integration with respect to the Kaehler volume form. And the corresponding 1-1 form is what we find here. All right, now. Now, we want to understand this formula and put it in a more general context. So let us look at the second Chern character form. And here is the definition. All right. Now, then we spell this out. What we get is fi beta bar alpha j bar. And then the other way around, then there is a minus sign from whatever switching differentials. And we have these things here. All of the other contributions don't matter for the integral. All right. And so what we see here is this first guy is what we exactly want to compute. And the second term has to be taken care of. And so the first term gives us the Weil-Petersson form. And for the second, we can use the Hermite-Einstein condition. We have here our lambda from the Hermite-Einstein condition. And then we have this trace contribution. So we want to eliminate that. And for that, we compute the second Chern character form of the endomorphism bundle. And then comes the computation. And if we are computing this kind of C1 squared thing, then again, we get two kinds of contributions, this one and that one. Now, the first, the second one is exactly what we want to compute. Here we get lambda from the Hermite-Einstein condition, and this is what we want to compute. The other one, well, the fi traces of fi beta bar, these correspond to the Kodaira-Spencer forms of defining the determinant of ES. But the determinant of ES is assumed to be constant, and now these things, the classes are zero, and now these are still harmonic, so this contribution is equal to zero, and so then we arrive at this formula here that we can write down some kind of description of the Weil-Petersson form in terms of a more general theory, so to speak. Okay. Okay. Now I come to the notion of determinant line bundles for proper holomorphic maps. So what is this? So we are given a proper smooth map of complex manifolds and a coherent sheaf on the total space. Then we can write down such things. And let us assume that all of these cohomology groups have the same rank. Then we can take the maximum, the lambda max of this thing. This is a copy of C. And then we have various copies of C, and then we take the tensor product. This doesn't really seem to be very convincing. But the point here, of course, is that all of these carry a natural L2 inner product once we have a Hermitian structure on the fibers. Okay. So that is the reason why this thing is being computed. All right. In case the rank is not constant, then one takes resolutions. In the algebraic case, it's easy. In the complex case, one would take some simplicial objects in whatever category. In any case, and which amounts to Foster-Knorr systems of coherent sheaves. Finally, there is also a very natural definition at for this thing, which is now called a determinant line bundle for the situation of F with respect to the map little f. So this thing possesses an L2 inner L2 norm, say, and this norm is being multiplied with the analytic torsion, which is derived from the zeta function for these for the Laplacians for all of these bundles. So we just use this machinery and the theorem of Bismuth, Gillé, and Soulet, which gives a answer to the following question. There is the Riemann-Roch-Hirzebruch-Grotendieck theorem, so the Riemann-Roch theorem for proper maps. And this is, of course, is a theorem about cohomology. And as opposed to cohomology groups, one would like to have cohomology together with Hermitian structures. And instead of having elements of certain cohomology groups, one would like to have these provided by provided with a Hermitian structure. And this is done here. So we see the general Riemann-Roch formula with some addition. Instead of Chern character, it says Chern character form. Here it says Todd character form, and this fiber integral is usually something like F lower exclamation or something like that. And we have here the fiber integral, and the two component in degree two, or let's say the component in degree 1.1, which amounts to the same thing, and then we have this formula. So there is this determinant line bundle equipped with a Quillen metric, which is the L2, L2 norm times analytic torsion. And this is, here on the other hand, the Riemann-Roch integral. Okay. So this is extremely useful. And it gives, so to speak, the generalization of Mumford's approach. And now we come to this, to the case where our orbifold is of Hodge type, and that we assume that the Kaehler form on X is the first Chern form of a positive or ample, whatever, line bundle with a Hermitian metric. Okay. Now, there is this kind of weird element, a formal sum and tensor product of certain bundles. So it will become very clear why such a thing is being introduced. Namely, we compute the Chern character form of F, and we know the Chern character first is additive and multiplicative. So we would say the Chern character of F is the Chern character of N minus the Chern character of this one. The whole thing tensorized with the one here on the right-hand side. So maybe let us begin with this one here. This would be 1 plus C1 of L tilde H, so 1 plus omega plus higher degree terms. And the Chern character of the trivial bundle is equal to 1 in degree 0 and otherwise 0. So this thing begins with C1 of L tilde H to the power n minus 1, which is quite a high degree already. And then we can do it this here. And so what do we have? Here, the degree 0 part is R squared minus R squared is 0. C1 of the endomorphism bundle is 0. So the whole thing starts with C2, with the second Chern character form, times omega to the n minus 1. So this is already of degree n plus 1 comma n plus 1. And so all we want to know about the Todd character form is that the lowest order degree term is equal to 1. So the next degree terms will no longer contribute to the integral. Okay, and then we have this form. And what we can see is here we reconstructed the what we had as integrant in the fiber integral formula for the fiber integral formula for the Weil-Petersson form. So the result is the following. On one hand, we have the curvature form of a Hermitian line bundle. And on the other hand, we have the Weil-Petersson form. Now, the Weil-Petersson form, that thing is positive definite. So this tells us also something about the line bundle here. Okay, so we have a positive line bundle whose curvature form is equal to the Weil-Petersson form up to numerical factors, which are all usually made from 2 and pi. Okay. Now, whole thing for orbifolds. So for the sake of completeness, I'm quoting maybe the first theorem along those lines by Atiyah and Singer, and I don't want to elaborate on this. So there is a theorem. Okay. And but 10 years later, Kawasaki generalized the Hirzebruch-Riemann-Roch theorem to orbifolds. And so the setup exists. And what we here can see is a new ingredient, namely the singular orbifold structure. So we have all of these quotients W over gamma. And gamma has fixed points. And the fixed point sets of gamma are intrinsic spaces. And one can see easily that these also carry an orbifold structure of their own. Meaning, so we write down the isotropy subgroup of a point, and then taking the fixed point sets divided by isotropy subgroups, these give us a kind of a hierarchy of orbifolds. And all of these contribute to the Riemann-Roch formula, and that is the result by Ma. And so what we have gotten is the same formula in his notation and Bismuth's notation. Here we have nabla lambda squared, which is the curvature. Here we have the same integrants, but there is this sum of the orbifolds from our hierarchy. And the MJs are the order of the ineffectivity kernel of lambda, of gamma. All right. So there is such a formula. And then we apply it to our orbifold structure. So we are looking at the Hermite-Einstein orbifold vector bundles. And what we get then is we can see that the contribution of the singular orbifolds vanishes, and we have the same result. Okay. Now comes, take a deep breath. Now comes the main theorem, a conjecture of André Telemann, that the Weil-Petersson form extends to a suitable compactification of the moduli space is a closed 1-1 current and with local potentials. When dealing with normal spaces, we need to be careful. There is no dB bar Poincaré lemma, and it is very clear that this cannot exist. Why? Well, desingularize the thing, then we are in a global situation, and then we would need a global dB bar Poincaré lemma, which is, of course, meaningless. So that is a point to take care of. So that is the theorem. When dealing about, when using theory of currents, the best one can have is work on normalization. Then one can say that this is not an issue. I will come to this in a minute. But when we can extend the curvature current of a line bundle, then we can also extend the line bundle. And for that, we need possibly to blow up the boundary, which is definitely necessary. And we are also in a position where we are maybe still a bit far from an explicit description of the compactifications of moduli spaces. So we are ready to expect that the boundary might have been to needs blowing up. Okay, so then the theorem says if we have a desingularization of the space such we can extend the pullback of the form as a closed positive current, what then? Then there exists a modification of the boundary such that the line bundle extends to the compactification. So there is one little thing to take care of. The pullback of a differential form is well defined. The pullback of a current is not well defined. Unless the current has a potential, then one would pull back the potential. We have pulled back the Purisa harmonic function which determines the current. And then we can take the dB bar. So that is the thing which works. So there are a couple of little things to take care of. In any case, our main theorem means that the determinant line bundle extends as a line bundle with a singular Hermitian metric to a suitable compactification. There is one remark. We do all of this for normalizations, and then one can say, well, one can also normalize a bit, namely normalize the boundary and keep the inner part as is. This can be done with a certain with an argument involving certain gap sheaves, which seem to be made exactly for this situation. Now we can reduce everything to a local statement. The reason being, if we extend a current, then it's not a unique process. So we cannot control. Well, it's very easy to say. Just as currents of integration along the boundary, then these would also yield new extensions of the current. Okay, so, but on the other hand, there is something, if we are dealing with positive current, there is something calling the null extension. So there is a way to throw all of this away, and then the construction becomes unique. And in the end, all of what we have to show is this statement. Okay. So we now look at a family of holomorphic vector bundles, which degenerates into coherent sheaves. And this is the local situation for any moduli space of holomorphic vector bundles. And it is not necessary, well, we can take any such family, and as we have seen before, the result will be always the same when we take this so-called null extent. Okay, so this is what we want to prove. And maybe Telemann stated his conjecture slightly more general way. He stated this without, say, analytic degeneration. But we have no idea what to do with transcendental degenerations. And on the other hand, we have this extension theorem in any case where the determinant line bundle would be extended, and that would be kind of a strong evidence that any such degeneration ought to be in terms of coherent sheaves. Okay. All right, and yeah, so this is what we want to do. Okay. Now comes how to extend the current. So we take a poly disk and a SNC divisor, say a union of certain coordinate hyperplanes. And we have our computation will take place on the complement. And what we need is estimates towards the locus of degeneration. And here, of course, in the heat equation approach, we need that certain determinants are equal to one. So here is the usual heat equation. And then we write down our original fiber integral formula for the Weil-Petersson form. Here it is. This is the formula. And what we want is we want to reduce the whole thing to the initial situation, where we replace the Hermite-Einstein matrix by the initial matrix for the heat equation approach. And there we can make estimates and then hope for the best that these will survive the heat equation. All right. So we have these contributions. And the next thing is, well, second term, the determinant of this thing is equal to one. That means the trace of the curvature form will be this thing here, will be the trace of the initial form. Okay. So here we already have the reduction to the initial situation for free, and we take care of this one. So question is, if we replace this by F0, which F0, the curvature of the initial Hermitian metric, what is the difference? That is well known. Namely, we write down the secondary Bott-Chern form. We take the difference, and then the difference is of the form IDD bar of the secondary Bott-Chern form. This is being plugged into the integral. And now here, if we integrate or take the fiber integral of this thing, then it is just the DD bar thing of the usual integral of the Bott-Chern form along the fibers. So this is kind of very convenient. What we get is the Donaldson functional, and then we take the limit. Now, here we see what is the error term if we replace in the fiber integral formula the curvature of the Hermite-Einstein matrix by the curvatures of the initial forms. The difference is just ID bar, DD bar of the Donaldson functional. Now, the Donaldson functional is known to be larger or equal to zero, and of course this persists or is a uniform upper bound even if we have a degeneration. So this is exactly what we want. And well, then if we apply a certain process, we are in this situation that we can estimate this contribution from above and below. And then then methods are available to look at push forwards of such things. And so there is a theorem that the push forward of positive currents is a positive current which possesses a plurisubharmonic potential. And well, this is how this is supposed to work. I don't know whether I'm ahead of myself. Anyway, now we let us see. The second term, this is refers to the construction which is still to come. And I will refer to this estimate later. What we can say is if we have such estimates, then we can control the Weil-Petersson forms, and it all comes down to saying that a bounded plurisubharmonic function is extendable, provided it's, well, if it's defined on a normal complex space, any bounded plurisubharmonic function can be extended into any lower dimensional analytic set. And this is what we are after here. Our estimates so far take place on x times s, and now comes the hard part. In any case, this is the idea how this is supposed to work. And now comes the technical part, construction of an initial metric for the heat equation. So we are looking at a polydisk, the complement of a set of union of hyper-coordinate hyperplanes. And then we assume that all sheaves are at the regular locus, at the good locus, are isomorphic to invertible, to one invertible sheaf of L on X. And we can already see that this would also, if we don't keep it fixed, this would also be a source of problems, because it all could degenerate, and then we are very much out of business. Okay. So we have the projections P and Q, and then we apply Ilonaka's flattening theorem. We apply a sequence of blow-ups with regular centers over x times a, and we arrive at a modification such that the pullback of our given coherent sheave mod torsion is locally free. Now, this construction looks very critical, because we blow up the total space. We still have a map to the base space, but the dimension of the fibers is by no means constant, because we have some exceptional fibers which could go to a point or something, and then the fibers are all of a different dimensions, and this has to be like that. Okay, then we just take the usual determinant bundle of the resulting pullback. And on the other hand, we still have the determinant bundle of the regular holomorphic vector bundles. This determinant bundle lives on X or on X times S. We pull it back to the deserialization, take the inverse, and multiply it by L tilde. And if we restrict everything to the nice locus, then of course we get a trivial bundle. Well, a trivial bundle is fine. So trivial bundle in the sense that it is fiber-wise trivial, meaning that this thing up here is a sheaf, which is, when restricted to X times S, is of the form pullback of a bundle on the parameter space. So this is all what we can say. So this is the essence of what we have done here. And now if we take a pullback of a line bundle and then take the push forward, then of course we get it back. So we arrive at a certain coherent sheaf L roof with the property that restricted to S prime, it's a holomorphic line bundle. Okay. Now, then we take Hironaka's flattening theorem once again, take a modification, pull it back, so that modulo torsion, we have an invertible sheaf. Can do that. Now, this is the situation, and we can see that all of these maps here are in general not flat, but we know what it is like over the locus S prime. It takes a moment to see that these two things, that the total spaces we have here, are still smooth. This one by construction, and that one, one has to look at it for a moment or two. All right, now we are in the end looking at our coherent sheaves. And so what do we get here? This is the previous construction, which over S prime kills everything. So over S prime, this thing is just trivial. And what we get is, well, there exists a meromorphic section of this line bundle that has no zeros over the previous locus. And now comes a point which is of a certain interest. So far, a singular Hermitian matrix for us, that was basically something with a growth condition, which is not too bad. It may go to infinity, but in a controlled way. And that is one thing. Of course, one can take the limit of such things, and then one arrives at something which is known from algebraic geometry. Namely, if we have a holomorphic line bundle, so whatever X is, then we can assume that sigma is a canonical section. Vanishing at a divisor, say, so L equals O of D, then there is a Hermitian metric, a singular Hermitian metric, namely 1 over sigma squared, absolute value. So this thing here, if we plug in another section, say tau, and put here tau absolute value squared and divide it by sigma absolute value squared, we get a function. So this is well defined. The only point is that that it is a meromorphic section. Okay. On the other hand, can also find C infinity Hermitian matrix which converge to this one. Now the question is, what is IDD bar log of this thing here, or minus squared? Well, this looks weird. Of the zero set of sigma, this is just zero, and on the zero set it is not defined. But in terms of singular Hermitian matrix, 1 over sigma squared is a singular Hermitian metric. One can write it down. And the curvature form, if we do it correctly, is then the current of integration over the divisor D. So this is the other special kind of Hermitian, singular Hermitian matrix. And like in the situation when writing down the Dirac delta function as a limit of a certain functions, a similar thing appears here, and this is exactly the corresponding situation. So what we have gotten here is a Hermitian metric which we can use to change the existing Hermitian metrics metric of the singular locus. And the good thing is, on the complement of the singular locus, the curvature is zero, so it doesn't change any curvature. Okay, so then we start with a Hermitian metric on E tilde. Remember, E tilde was the thing where we kind of made the given coherent sheaf E locally free. And then we can use this thing here to change the metric, so don't pay any attention to this formalism. It just means to remove everything until we are left with a function, and then we can take an initial Hermitian metric on E tilde and modify it in this way. And the crucial point is now, in order to use the whole machinery, we need need a family of initial Hermitian metrics which doesn't degenerate too badly, with the extra condition that the determinant is constant to one. And so this process does it. And so in the end, we arrive at a kind of a controllable initial Hermitian metric, so that the we can look at just a second. Now we go back. So what we wanted. So we look at this blue formula. Okay, this is bounded from above by zero. And these two things can be controlled so that we can extend our extend a DD bar potential for the Weil-Petersson form, meaning we extend the Weil-Petersson form as a current. So thank you very much.